Hey, I'm Mitchell Holmes, and I am the Children's Director at our Waterford location. Thank you so much for checking out this message. We're glad you're here, and we would love to get connected with you and your family. One easy way that you can do that is by texting the word River Connect to 97000. That's River Connect, all one word, to 97000. You can also visit our website at theriverchurch.cc to learn more about us and some upcoming events. Lastly, if you'd like to give to the River Church today, you can text the amount that you'd like to give to 84321, or you can head to our website and click on the Giving tab at the top of the page. Thanks again for joining us. We hope you enjoy today's message.
If you are new, I want to welcome you. If you're just rejoining the River Church after maybe a vacation, we are in the book of Revelation. So if you would turn to Revelation chapter 20, put your finger there. We're going to bounce a lot, but we're always coming back to Revelation chapter 20. We're about 80% of the way through the book. We have 4 weeks left, and we know that people have a lot of questions. People have a lot of thoughts. People say, hey, what's going on? So I wanted to give you a quick thing. If you want to text a question to 97000, you can. You can text the word Revelation to 97000, and you can ask your question, and we'll assign that to a pastor to try to get that question answered or get you some resources back to you. So notice I said the word Revelation. There's no S. You know, people tell me they shop at Myers. His name was Frederick Meyer. They work at Ford's. His name was Henry Ford. Okay, so there's no S. So in Revelation, there is no S. So if you type it with an S, I don't actually know what happens, but it does not get to us. So we do not get it. And I was so excited to be here. It's such a friendly church. I thought people were waving at me. But I realize they're just fanning. So I haven't been to a church where we're raising hands and fanning that much, but I'm excited about it. But I also wanted to take an opportunity, as Pastor Josh said, how exciting that we as a church can gather together while our facilities, while our resources, while our tools can be remodeled and revamped so that we can better meet the needs of our community, better minister to people in our community, right? And help seek and save the lost through the power of Jesus Christ. So it's an exciting time. I know last week Pastor Josh taught on Armageddon, the war to end all wars, right? The battle to end all battles. I was super impressed. He put pictures up. I don't have any pictures, I'm sorry. He put pictures up of his trip there to the Holy Lands and I loved in his message how he mentioned how we long for justice in this world, but realizing that sometimes maybe we wouldn't. Because God, Jesus Christ, when he died on the cross, none of us deserve the payment that he paid for us. And I thought that was super important for us to hear, that Jesus bought us. And there's much more to come, which is why we are studying the book of Revelation. As I've preached at several locations, I'm overwhelmed because people, you know, they get wound up about Revelation. They get wound up about the wrath of God. They get wound up. And I want to make sure that I clearly present to you that the wrath of God that we do see in Revelation is not random. Sometimes when we get into it and we start reading and it just feels so random, right? There's going to be these judgments. There's going to be these terrible things that happen to the planet that we live on. But I want to remind us that God has a plan. And in that plan, God has withheld his wrath. Not only has he withheld his wrath, the scripture tells us that he has withheld Satan's power. He has restrained him at some level. He has restrained the Antichrist, the work of lawlessness. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, you don't have to turn there, it'll be on the screen. It says, "For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he's out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming." And so as I've been answering a lot of questions for people and as I've been trying to help people, they get wound up in the terrible, the terrifying, the mystifying, the great puzzle. But I want to encourage us, do not miss the revelation of Jesus Christ. Do not miss the revelation of Jesus Christ. That's what the book of Revelation is. It is the revelation of Jesus Christ. Do not miss him as Lord. Do not miss him as Savior. Are there terrible and terrifying things? Yes. Are there puzzling things that's difficult for us to understand? Yes. But we cannot forget, one commentator stated it this way, and I just love because I think it just basically takes the book of Revelation and surrounds it in a nice package for us. It says, Jesus is Lord. Jesus was crucified. Jesus has risen from the grave. Jesus has ascended to heaven. Jesus is reigning on a throne there. And one day, Jesus is returning. And that's what the study of the book of Revelation is about for us in this section. He is returning. We can't miss that. So Pastor Josh said it so eloquently. He said, the bottom line, we are looking for Jesus in Revelation. He is coming back. Now, many of you might know this, but I grew up in a church not far from here that has a big picture of Jesus on the side of the expressway. And I grew up there, and it says, are you on the right road? You know, and everyone, aren't we so witty, right? Aren't we so witty? And so, you know, people say, oh, what do you mean? We get a lot of letters. We get a lot of feedback. Like, people love it, and people hate it. It's one of those things. And people hate it so much, at one point in my childhood, we had to raise money to help protect Jesus. Because people were angry, throwing things, shooting things, trying to light things. You know, people get wild up, you know? They get wild up, right? They're like, hey, I'm mad at God, right? There's a good picture of him. Let me take a blast at it, right? And so we raised some money to take him down and repair him and fix him. And we put up a sign that said, Jesus is coming back soon. Boy, did that get people riled up. Oh, man. Oh, man, but we don't want to miss that. Even at the church, sometimes we get a little, you know, hey, I want this to happen in my life. I want that to happen. His judgment, his wrath, his plan is not random. It has an overall purpose, and we don't want to miss that. So this morning, I want to bring you a message called the Millennium. Will you pray with me? Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together to hear your word taught and presented. Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit would work in a mighty way. I know it has nothing to do with me. It is just an explanation of your word, and we give you the honor and the glory for it. And Lord, we give the honor and glory for the work that's going to happen in the hearts of people who hear the message and hear your word and are moved to change. We give you the honor and the glory for the people that may hear your message today and come to a realization that they need to be saved. They need to be baptized. They need to serve. They need to change. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, you can equip that, Lord. You give that freely. So we love you. We thank you for this morning. We ask your blessing on our time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. The millennium. The millennium. And now, a lot of people poke at the millennium. They say, wasn't that weird? Cedar Point named a ride after something in Revelation. Or people poke, and you know the word millennium is not in the Bible. I go, well, you know the word the Trinity is not in the Bible either. Right? These are words that are created to describe something that we clearly see taught in the Scripture. So the millennium really is a word that means 1,000 years. Okay, a millennium. We know theologically, as believers in Christ, when we study the Scripture, we know the millennium to be the 1,000-year reign of Christ at the end of time. And some people go, well, you know, I'm not comfortable with the book of Revelation. I'm not comfortable with some of these things because they feel these things are only taught or only presented in the book of Revelation. But I always push back and say, listen, guys, I know that you might be uncomfortable with the millennium, 1,000-year reign of Christ. You don't understand it, but we don't want to miss this. The millennium was taught in the Old Testament by the following books. Taught in Deuteronomy, Samuel, Psalm, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Micah, Zephaniah, and Zechariah. So when people, that's only taught in Revelation. No, it's not only taught in the book of Revelation. It's taught in the New Testament by the different writers, Matthew, Acts, Romans, Jude, and Revelation. So that's John, Paul, Matthew, Luke, and the brother of Jesus, Jude. All discuss the thousand-year reign, the coming earthly kingdom of Jesus Christ on this planet. So we don't want to miss it. So if you'll turn with me to Revelation chapter 20, we are going to read verses 1 through 10 together. Revelation 20, 1 through 10. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, that ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years and threw him into the pit and shut it and sealed it over him so that he might not deceive the nations any longer until the 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be released for a little while. Then I saw thrones, and seated on them were those to whom the authority to judge was committed. Also, I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God, and those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their forehead or on their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ. They will reign with him for 1,000 years. And when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison and will come out to deceive the nations that are at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea, and they marched up over a broad plain of the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. But fire came down from heaven and consumed them, and the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. There's both in that section of scripture, there's things that are very encouraging and uplifting, and then there's those things that seem pretty terrifying. Deep. Looking at setting the stage for the coming kingdom of Jesus Christ. Many on this planet tell me all the time, peace, peace, what's your one goal in life? Peace, I just world peace, right? Every Miss America or Mr. Universe or Mrs. You, whatever, you know, what's your one wish, you know? Peace. There will not be peace. We know that God is withholding his wrath and he's restraining the lawless one. There will not be peace until this earthly kingdom. As we've studied the book of Revelation so far, we know there's not peace. Many of the commentators, they said, just imagine. So I want us to imagine together. Let's just imagine a world that will be dominated by righteousness, goodness, and justice. Imagine a world where everyone is treated fairly in every aspect of their life. That's the earthly kingdom. Imagine where family relationships, some of us carry a heavy burden from our family relationships, where no one will be mistreated within their family. Imagine a world where the educational system is perfectly in line with the word of God and his teaching. Imagine that. Some of us have been mistreated or not serviced correctly by the educational system, or some of us may have been shunned or put down by the educational system. Let's imagine that. Let's imagine a governmental structure, a criminal justice structure, where all decisions are made perfectly. Some of us have been mistreated by our educational system, our governmental system, our criminal justice system. I mean, as a teacher of history, I love to look back at history, but over and over again, I can tell you government after government that mistreated its people, all the way from setting Christians on fire at the end of our work, God's word, where it has been recorded for us, all the way to letting them be eaten by animals, all the way to genocide, where the people who had the rights to make the laws mistreated people. But that will not be the case. Imagine a commerce system, a vocational system, right? How many of you have been lost a job for nothing you did wrong? How many have been trapped in a house because the market changed, right? How many of you had difficulty finding a house because of a place to live because of a market structure, right? Imagine a perfect system. Imagine our world being regenerated, right? I mean, a few weeks ago, all anybody wanted to talk to me, Roy, have you heard about the fire in Canada? Have you heard about the fire in Canada, right? I'm like, guys, that's like 9 million acres. I know that's a lot, but nobody lives there. Okay? Like, can you imagine the tragedy and the devastation with the wrath of God that we have read about, his judgments on this planet? 9 million acres is going to be like a Sunday school class compared to what's going to be burning. And it does affect things, right? I drove up to our young adult retreat. It was 93 degrees when I left Grand Blanc, Michigan, heading up to our camp a couple hours north. Sun is shining, 93 degrees. I'm driving, 88, 87, 82. The sun is still shining. I had my wife, I'm like, something's wrong. You're hitting her car gauge, like something's wrong, right? Check your phone, what's going on? Why is the temperature drastically reducing? We called the camp. Oh, we just put the kids on the, it's young adults, they aren't kids. We just put the young adults on the river and it's like 90 degrees. I'm like, oh, cool. By the time I got to Bay City, it was 68 degrees and the sun was still shining. And what had happened is the fire had let so many contaminants into the atmosphere that the UV, the heat of the sun, was being redirected. And the temperature, and so all the kids, all the young adults got off and they're like, it's freezing cold. It was 92 when we got on. You know, I'm like, oh yeah, that stinks. You know, that's terrible. You know what it was? It was the fire, right? Imagine a world where natural disasters like that don't happen. Imagine. This is the picture that we get. This is the picture that we get of the coming earthly kingdom of Jesus Christ. Even the animals, I know some of us like to hunt and some of us like to do things, right? You know, I'm a sucker for those, you know, there's an alligator in the water and there's three, you know, gazelles down by the pond getting ready. I just love it, you know, or where the tiger is getting ready to take the deer or whatever it is out there on the plain of Africa, you know, and you know, how they're going to fight back. And, you know, there is tension in this world, animals, right? If you have animals, right? You know, a friend of mine has a 2.5-pound dog. I have a lot of hawks near me. So I say, hey, you know, you better tie that dog to something because if not, it's gone. Okay, I would not be letting it out in the backyard. You know, it's going to be gone. Like, there are hawks. It will be gone. When I catch things, I have to get out there quickly because the bird tries to grab them and take off with them, and then they take my trap. I'm upset about it. So let's go back to Revelation 20. We'll break down the first three verses. Revelation 20. Verses 1 through 3. It says, then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain. And he seized the dragon, that ancient serpent, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years and threw him into a pit and shut it and sealed it over him so that he might not deceive the nations any longer until the 1,000 years were ended. After that, he must be released for a little while. So I really studied up on this, and a lot of the commentators are talking to me like, this is an angel who has a pretty important job, but we know this angel was given the authority. How do we know he was given the authority? Because he has a key, and he has a chain, and it's a great chain, and he will be binding the devil, and we know it's the devil, right? We know he's pretty powerful. The scripture tells us that he is the god of this world. In 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4, it says, in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. We know he is a powerful person to contend with, and we know he will be bound by this great chain, put into the bottomless pit, the abyss, and the angel will seal it for the earthly kingdom. So we know he has some authority. We know there's a lot going on here. We also know who it is. We know that it's Satan because it says it's Satan. And if you don't understand who Satan is, that's our adversary. But if you didn't understand who Satan was, the scripture made it clear. It's the devil. Who's the devil? He's the king of liars. He's the father of liars. He's the liar, the gossip, the manipulator, the slanderer. It's the devil. If you don't understand that, it's the ancient serpent. If you want to go all the way back to the very first story that we like to record in the Garden of Eden, where you see the serpent in his cunningness, the ancient serpent. So we know over and over in the book of Revelation, it refers to him as the dragon. So he gives us all four names there in the scripture. But it was interesting to me, this special holding place. I recently was called down to Oakland County Jail, and they said I was going to visit somebody, okay? I wasn't called, like, arrested, but I was called to visit somebody. That's like, people are like, whoa, he was in Oakland County Jail. Yeah, I went down there to visit, and I was actually kind of shocked when I got into the holding area, right? They're not treated well. It's difficult. Now, I'm not blaming anybody. It's a crazy situation to be in. You know, there could be too many people for the size of the holding cell. This is the little sliver of something that I get to sit on so that I can visit and try to love and care for this person. They might have to be chained to the wall for me to be able to speak to them. So even though it is a holding area, it's still, you're confined. You're still being watched. Your liberties are diminished. It's a difficult spot to be in, even when somebody's coming to minister to you through the word of Jesus Christ, right? We see this picture of it being a holding place. But where is this holding place? What was the beginning of this holding place? So I looked at it and we studied it, and it was very interesting to me. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, verses 28 through 31, there's a demonstration of Jesus' power when he is going to free a man from a bunch of demons. And there's an interesting interaction here. So I wanted to read Luke chapter 8, starting in verse 28. It says, when he saw Jesus, this is the man that has the demons, the demon-possessed man, he cried out and fell down before him and said with a loud voice, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, do not torment me. It seems like an interesting interaction. We don't have a lot of recording of Jesus tormenting people in the New Testament. For he had commanded the unclean spirit to come out of the man. For many a time it had seized him. He was kept under guard and bound with chains and shackles that he could not break, and he would break the bonds and be driven by the demon into the desert. And Jesus said to him, what is your name? And he said, Legion, for many demons had entered him, and they begged him not to command them to depart into the abyss. When we study this, this is the same reference. These demons, some of them have been sent to the abyss. It is the same abyss that we call the bottomless pit. So there is this place where people are held. We know that in our study of Revelation chapter 9, I believe, that some of these demons were let out to torture unbelievers in Revelation, torment unbelievers in chapter 9 of Revelation. It's very, very interesting that right now, the devil is being restrained. But at the time of the tribulation, he will be loosed. And then we get to the millennium, he's not restrained or loosed, he's in the abyss. And a bunch of us, when I read this and I've studied this over the years, I'm like, this is going to be awesome. This is going to be incredible. There will be no influence from Satan and his demons on this earth. The people of this earth will not have to contend with that. They will not have to contend with what's going on. One commentator said it this way. He said, he will not be permitted to influence the world in any way. Shut up, sealed, bottomless pit, locked, chained. But at the end of the story, he will be released for a little while. Revelation chapter 20, starting in verse 4. Then I saw the thrones, and seated on them were those to whom the authority to Jesus was committed. Excuse me, the authority to judge was committed. Also I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for the testimony of Jesus and for the word of God and for those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received its mark on their forehead or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were ended. This is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy is the one who shares in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power, but they will be priests of God and of Christ, and they will reign with him for 1,000 years. So what do we see in this next picture of the vision that he sees? We see thrones, judges, rulers, and those who are sitting on them have authority. We get a lot of questions about this. Who are these people reigning with him? There are lots and lots of different ideas about who is reigning with Christ. I have studied it. Some of the staff will tell you, I took them into the conference room and I'm, you know, this scripture says this and this scripture says this and this is what we see. And it seems to me that every generation of Christian believes that they will be with Christ ruling in the millennium if they die before the tribulation or during the tribulation. So there are Old Testament scriptures in Daniel that would lead you to believe that the Old Testament faithful, Old Testament saints, if you would, will be there. There's no question in Matthew 19 that Jesus said to his apostles, truly I say to you, in the new world, when the Son of Man will sit on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, or do you not know that the saints will judge the world? So that's a New Testament reference to the church. So I tell people, the people of God will be there ruling. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 10 through 13. It says, therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we also will live with him. If we will endure, we will also reign with him. So we see that picture. We see the picture of these tribulation saints, these tribulation believers, the ones who did not bow down to the image, the ones who did not take the mark of the beast, the ones who did not do these things. And they will be part of what the scripture describes as the first resurrection. And people say to me, what is the first resurrection? How do you get to be part of the first resurrection? I said, it's pretty basic here. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you want to be part of the first resurrection, and the scripture there said, blessed are you, if you want to be part of it, you have to accept and believe and confess that Jesus Christ is the way. I know this is controversial in this world. I know this is difficult for some of the churches down the street. I see their signs. There's many doors. There's many ways. How intolerant are you for saying, I go, I'm not saying, I'm reading the scriptures to you. Jesus said, I am the way. Luke chapter 19, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. If there were many ways, then why is he coming to seek and save? Why did he have to humble himself? Why did he have to take that penalty? Why did he have to die on a cross? Because there isn't many ways. Jesus says, I am the way. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 says, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. There's many here this morning I know have accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior. And sometimes as I started this sermon, we can take it for granted. And some of you don't know what I'm talking about, and we don't want you to miss it. I don't want people to take this for granted. I don't want people to miss it. Jesus Christ is the way, the righteous for the unrighteous, so that we can be made alive in the Spirit. So please, the scripture says clearly, today is the day of salvation. If you feel moved in any way, please speak to someone. Please come forward after the gathering and speak to Pastor Josh or myself or a deacon or a staff person. Please, today is the day as the Spirit moves you. For those of us, well, I've been saved 50 years. Great, don't take it for granted. Let's not just sit back and put it on cruise control. Why do we do camps? Because we don't want to put it on cruise control. Why do we do summer outings? We don't want to put it on cruise control. Why do we take the time to baptize? People say, well, why do you guys baptize? You don't have to be baptized to get to heaven. It's the first act of obedience. We're not wanting to put it on cruise control. We don't want to take it for granted that people's lives are changed through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the presentation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Church, we cannot miss this. Back to Revelation chapter 20, verse 7. And when the 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison and will come out to deceive the nations that are at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea. Like the sand of the sea. And they marched up over a broad plain on the earth and surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. But fire came down from heaven and consumed them. And the devil who had deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Something that I missed in my study over the years of the millennium is how terrible an ending. How terrible an ending. Like what? Like, do I give the devil too much credit? Like Eve, Adam, they screwed up in the garden, but you know what? The devil was there. And they chose their sin and their selfishness and their self-centeredness. They wanted to be gods. Okay, I get it. He was there. And then throughout all of recorded history, we know that the devil is like a roaring lion, right? We know that he's seeking to devour. We know that his demons are at work in this world. But in the millennium, they're not there. They're bound. Jesus Christ will be ruling. His saints will be helping him rule. All the systems of this world will be correct. And the devil will be in a holding cell with no influence. Interesting that this is the ending to an almost perfect world. Almost perfect, but our sinful nature comes to the front. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 3 through 5. Paul says, but I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. We see pictures in the Old Testament that says, you know, don't trust your heart. Your heart is wicked. It's deceitful. It's sick. We see in Romans where it says futile thinking and a darkened heart. We see here where it says Paul is afraid that our thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. In verse 4, it says, for if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one we proclaimed. You say, do people proclaim another Jesus? Yes. If they proclaim another way, they're proclaiming another Jesus. Or if you received a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel from the one you accepted, will it be because of our thoughts? We seem to see this playing out in the millennium. We seem to see that they will be obedient. They will do the right things. They will say the right things. They will submit to the right things. Many of the commentators believe that with the renewed millennial kingdom, his earthly kingdom, that many of us, if we made it through a tribulation period, will be living long periods of time. And so many of the commentators believe these will be the children of the redeemed that are still alive. These are the kids whose parents saw what happened and redeemed and made it and get to see Christ ruling on a throne. And yet, a number as big as the sands of the sea, that's a lot of people. I know it's not the actual number of sand, But that's meant to tell us this is a huge number of people. This isn't five people that rise up in hatred to God. This isn't people who rise up in their own. This is a large number of people that everything is almost perfect. One of the pastors that I like to read from said, amazingly, despite the personal rule of Christ on earth, despite the most moral society that the world will ever know, many others will love their sin and reject Jesus. Even the utopian conditions of the millennium will not change the sad reality of human depravity. Romans 8:7 says, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. Satan will pull together a worldwide rebellion. They will move to attack Jesus and the saints and Jerusalem. And interesting that the judgments, all these judgments, didn't change people's hearts. They went up into the mountains and cried for the mountains to cover them up. And then now, utopia, peace, world peace, enforced world peace, a perfect leader, a perfect king, a perfect education system, a perfect government, a perfect criminal justice system, a perfect commerce system, a perfect world. Animals don't kill each other, right? Perfect, almost perfect, because we're here. And the depravity of man shows itself in rebellion to God. The only thing that can change the hearts of sinners is the grace of God. It's the only thing. So why do we say today is the day of salvation? Why do we say confess with your mouth and believe? Why do we say come forward in an act of obedience and be baptized? Why do we say these things? Because of the grace of God. Grace. God's grace that can forgive us from our sins. But in verses 9 and 10 of Revelation 20, fire came down from heaven and consumed them. And the devil, who had deceived them, was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Will you stand with me, church? Let's pray. Lord, we love you, and we're so thankful for the opportunities that you give us to come together, Lord. We're so thankful for the opportunities you give us to see people baptized. We're so thankful, Lord, for the opportunities that you give us to sing together in a wonderful music and harmony together and lifting our voices in praise to you. Lord, I saw people praying this morning. I saw people loving each other, meeting each other's needs, encouraging one another. We don't want to take this for granted, Lord. I saw the kids go to camp and come back from camp, Lord. I've seen the registration number for next week, Lord. We are so thankful for the opportunity to love these little ones, to be a church that has this opportunity in submission to you, in submission to your will. Lord, Revelation can be scary. We don't understand it all, but we're so thankful for the blessing that you told us. Blessed are those of us who read it and try to apply it. Blessed are those of us in the first resurrection, those of us who've come to that saving knowledge. Lord, I pray those here today who can hear my voice, whether it's online or in person, that they would come forward, get their questions answered, that they would submit. Lord, I pray for those today that maybe have done that but have never been baptized. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of obedience. Please come forward if you want to be baptized and speak with the worker. Lord, we love you. We love you. We love you. We ask all this in your name, the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.